A very warm welcome to all of you. Today I'm going to be starting with my lecture in advances in aeronautics. So this is a two-part lecture. So by the end of the lecture, you would have gained a little bit of insight into some of the advances made in our field with aspects to diagnosis, working length determination, cleaning and shaping, and obturation. So these are the contents. So you have the advances in the diagnostic devices, digital imaging devices, and the injection techniques, irrigating devices. Then of course we have our electronic apex locators and advances in cleaning, shaping and obturation. So coming to the advances in the field of diagnosis, I'm sure you are all aware of transillumination. It has been covered in your year 4 as well. This test, as you know, it helps to identify your crown fractures, because when you shine a very bright light through the tooth, the fracture line will not be able to transmit this light. So you will be able to see this contrasting dark and light areas at the fracture site, as it is very evidently clear in the picture on the right. So it can also be helpful in detecting your interproximal caries, so that those photos will be coming in the later slides. So all you have to do is just direct a high intensity light directly on the surface of the tooth, preferably at the level of the CEJ, so that you can gain the visibility for the entire tooth surface. Coming to fiber optic imaging. So the components are, it has a camera, a light source and a monitor, yeah? So where you can actually control and see the results. So it is used for your intraoral visualization. So basically they are composed of these thin fibers which are flexible, and they are made of high quality glass or plastic. And they are very, very small. They can be as small as 0.01 mm in diameter. And so they can be primarily used for detecting your interproximal caries, like I was mentioning in the previous slide. So fiber optics, they are however nowadays also used for illumination in conjunction with your handpieces. So I'm sure a lot of you would have seen the aerotors which have a small LED light as well, which is attached at the head. So as soon as the turbine starts the aerotor, along with the water spray, there is also a beam of light which is shining. So it gives you an adjunctive illumination as well. Yeah. So as you can see in the photos, it's very, very useful for detecting your interproximal caries, and it can also help you evaluate the existing restorations as well. So if you are shining the light interproximally in the areas of interproximal restorations, so you can actually see whether there is secondary caries or marginal caries along the lines of the restoration, so you can take the necessary action. Coming to laser Doppler flowimetry and pulse oximetry. So, as we all know, the true vitality tests are the laser Doppler flowimetry and the pulse oximetry, because the electric pulse tests and your thermal tests, they're not reliable in diagnosing the pulpal status, because they only provide information about the nerve supply to the teeth. They do not clarify whether there is any blood supply left to the teeth or not. So they can never be called as the true pulp testers. So, and even in the cases of teeth which have been traumatically injured, or the teeth which have immature root formation, or teeth with open apex, that is your blunderbuss canals, in such cases your electric pulp testers and your thermal tests are unreliable, which is why we require the true pulp testers like laser Doppler flowimetry and pulse oximetry. However, they are quite expensive and not easy to procure, yeah, because they assess the blood supply of the tooth. So what is laser Doppler flowimetry? It uses an electro-optical technique. So you have to put a fiber optic probe against the tooth surface. A light is shown from the laser, okay, and it is transmitted through the crown towards the dental pulp with the help of this probe, which also returns the light which is reflected after the light hits against the dental pulp, and it is reflected back to the flow meter, that is the part of the instrument which actually evaluates the blood flow. So this light reflected, as you know, the blood, that is the pulp, will have the RBCs, and RBCs, that is your red blood cells, they're not stationary, they keep moving, yeah, they keep flowing inside the blood. So this light reflected from the moving RBCs will show a shift in the frequency, and this is nothing but your Doppler effect. And the light which is reflected from your stationary objects, so you might have nerve fibers, or you might have other components in your blood which are stationary and which did not move. So this light will remain unshifted. So the comparison between this between the light which is reflected from stationary and the light which is reflected from your moving cells will determine whether your tooth is vital or not. Yeah, because if the RBCs are flowing in circulation, that means your tooth is very much vital. Coming to your pulse oximetry, this is the other true vitality test. It is again non-invasive, and it just measures your hemoglobin saturation of oxygen. Yeah, so it combines two technologies. One is your spectrophotometry, and the other is your plethysmograph. So the spectrophotometry is the component which measures the saturation of hemoglobin in your blood, and the plethysmograph measures the pulsatile changes in your blood volume. Okay, so how does this work? Again, this has a light source which consists of two LEDs. They both emit at different wavelengths. Okay, one is at 660 nanometer and the other is at 940 nanometer. And inside the instrument there is a computer which will actually calculate the saturation of oxygen based on the absorption ratio of these two wavelengths of light. Yeah, so it will just calculate whether the oxygen saturation is high or low. So dependently it will show whether the tooth is vital or not. So the higher the saturation, the more the probability that the tooth is vital. Yes, so these are extremely reliable, but of course they are expensive as well. Now, coming to your advances in diagnostic imaging, I am sure you are all aware of the radiovisiograph because it has already been installed in both the Department of Conservative as well as, if I'm not mistaken, it's in the Department of Pediatrics as well. So the disadvantages of your conventional x-rays, that is the IOPA films which we have been using along with the traditional x-rays, is the first is the higher amount of radiation exposure. So you can actually reduce it by to 1/10 of the actual exposure when you use your radiovisiograph. The film is not rigid, the IOPA film is not rigid, and hence the bending can result in a distorted radiographic image. So we all know how difficult it is to place an IOPA, especially in the posterior components, in the posterior areas of the mouth. So in such cases, inadvertently you might bend the film for better placement, and that bending can lead to distortion of your image. Film processing is relatively time consuming because you have to juggle between the developer fixer and you have to wash it as well in between. And of course you have to maintain a dark room for it. A specific dark room has to be maintained, so you have to pay the rent for an additional room. You have to pay for the fixer, you have to pay for the developer, yeah, and you have to pay for the red light, although the red light is not very expensive. Yeah. Duplication of x-ray films is a disadvantage. You have to shoot an x-ray multiple times, whereas the RVG, it can be duplicated to the power of infinity. Yeah, so that is why that is one very very good advantage. So what are the advantages of having your digital radiography? There is a reduced time between exposure and image formation. So as soon as you shoot the image, you don't have to waste time in developing it. The image will be readily formed on your screen. The reduced dosage, it is 1/10 the value when compared to your traditional IOPAs. You have imaging tools which will help you to estimate your working length. So you can also use your scale, you can increase or decrease the contrast to actually appreciate the periapical region, so on and so forth. You don't need to do your chemical processing, so you don't have to worry about even the disposal of your spent chemicals, that is your radiographic fixer and developer. The images can be duplicated as many times as you want, and of course they can be stored and retrieved as and when you want. Enhancing of the image, like I said, the contrast, the color, the scale for the measurements, everything can be manipulated digitally. So what are the components of your radiovisiography? It consists of four basic components: the X-ray set with an electronic timer, an intraoral sensor, that is what you place inside the patient's mouth, a display processing unit, that is your computer screen, and of course the printer if you want to print out the images. So this computer chip, that is your intraoral sensor, it is composed of a charged coupled device which captures light which is emitted from a phosphor plate which is placed just behind the sensor when it is hit by the X-rays. So what happens is, as soon as the X-rays hit this phosphor plate, it emits light, and this light is captured by your charged coupled device. This light is then transmitted to the computer, which is then digitized and displayed in the form of an image on the computer screen. So this is how your digital radiograph works, your radiovisiograph. So as you can see in the diagram, you have the X-ray source, that is your X-ray tube, and of course you have your sensor, which is to be placed inside the patient's mouth, which has both the charged coupled device and the phosphor plate. Which when is exposed to X-ray emits light. The phosphor plate will emit light, which is captured by this charged coupled device, and it is transmitted to the screen, and after digitizing you can appreciate the image on the screen. And then of course, if you wish to print the image, you just have to connect it to the printer, and you can have as many copies as you want. Now coming to your advantages in the field of injections, we have one which is known as the Stabilent system. It is a refinement of your conventional intraosseous injection technique. Okay, so basically it is nothing but you are going to be drilling a very small hole into your bone. This is preferentially done in the mandible because the mandible has denser bone and sometimes the LA may be ineffective. So in the maxilla, because the bone is very porous, your local anesthesia tends to flow freely, more freely, and because of which it is able to perfuse through tissues and it is able to give the desired anesthesia almost all the time. The mandible, however, is a different story altogether, and because of the density of the bone, the higher density of the bone, it is difficult sometimes to actually achieve your anesthesia, which is why this recent advance was invented. So it consists of a perforator and an injector. So the perforator is used to actually drill the bone. It is a very small wire, a 9mm 27 gauge wire. So you can imagine the size of the orifice. So as soon as an orifice is created in the bone, the injection is fit into the orifice, and you are just injecting the local anesthesia directly into that perforated site, because of which the local anesthesia will have better action. So this perforator is run on a slow speed handpiece in order to penetrate your cortical bone, and it is driven until it drops into the cancellous bone. So you are just penetrating from the cortical into the cancellous so that the local anesthesia can perfuse better and give you better results. So the aim is to create a small hole just enough to facilitate the easy entry of the needle directly up to the cancellous bone. And like I said, it is more commonly used for your lower molars, especially in the cases of hot tooth. It can provide quite a lot of relief. Yeah, so you can keep the Stabilent. Now, how to select the site for the injection? You have to imagine a horizontal line along the gingival margins of the teeth. Okay, and you have to imagine the vertical line through the interdental papilla. So a point about 2 mm apical to where these lines meet is usually the suitable site. So as you can see in the first figure, the horizontal line is along the gingival margins of the teeth in the mandible, The vertical line is through the interdental papilla between the second premolar and the first molar, and just 2 mm apical to that site is where the X marks the spot, is where you have to drill the bone. Yeah, and that is how. So you are going to be injecting directly into cancellous bone, so your results will be more favorable. Now coming to your ultrasonics in endodontics. So this is quite important because this is one of the most advantageous recent advances, because the uses of ultrasonics in endodontics is manifold. So what is ultrasound? I'm sure this has been covered in the department of periodontics in your year 4. So it's just a quick revision for you guys. So ultrasound is nothing but sound energy with a frequency above the range of human hearing, so which is around 20 kilohertz. So actually ultrasonics was advocated or introduced into dentistry for cavity preparations, but of course it never became popular because our handpieces are much more useful. And they're much more convenient and much more effective. That is your high speed handpiece. So then the use for ultrasonics actually went off into the department of periodontics, because it was found that it is proving a very useful tool to dislodge substances from the tooth structure. This is why you are using it for the removal of dental calculus and plaque in the department of periodontics. The uses of ultrasonics in endodontics are manifold, so I'll be coming to that in the next slide. So I'm sure you all know that there are two basic methods for producing ultrasound: the magnetostrictive and the piezoelectric. Of course, the piezoelectric is more advantageous, and this is what we use because we don't have to deal with the heat issue. Yeah, so the heat generated is lesser. Also, the movement which is created because of the piezoelectric is much more favorable in dentistry when compared to your magnetostrictive. Yeah, so the magnetostrictive converts your electromagnetic energy into mechanical energy. And how is this done? These metal strips in the handpiece are subjected to a standing and alternating magnetic field, because of which the vibrations are produced. So this is how your magnetostrictive works. Whereas the piezoelectric, there is a crystal which is present inside the handpiece, which changes dimension when a charge of electricity is applied. This deformation in the crystal is converted into mechanical oscillation without producing heat. So in the magnetostrictive, you have the issue of heat which is generated, and this heat of course can cause trauma to your hard and soft tissues, which is why the piezoelectric is much more beneficial. Yeah. So now this is the list of the most frequent applications of ultrasonics in endodontics. The first is your axis refinement. That means you can refine your axis cavity prep. You can help. You can use the help of ultrasonics to find your calcified canals, and you can use it to remove your attached pulp stones. So when you have performed your axis cavity prep, the chances of finding the canals are significantly higher when it comes to using ultrasonics. So if you are impatient and if you continue to try locating your canals with the help of the handpiece and the burr, it will inadvertently lead to the perforation, which is why we tend to use the ultrasonics. And if you do not want to use the ultrasonics, at least use stick to your dental explorer, or that is your endodontic explorer, or a sharp straight probe, because if you continue to use your handpiece and the burr, you will perforate the floor, and then of course the management is a whole new story, and it is much more difficult. You can also use the ultrasonics to cause vibrations and detach the pulp stones from the chamber. So in case you want to use in case you come across a tooth which has been under chronic irritation for a long time, chances of finding pulp stones in the chamber are significantly high. So if you do not wish to use the spoon excavator, if you are scared that you will damage the floor of the chamber, in such cases you can also use your ultrasonic tips. Of course, the ultrasonic tips which are used in endodontics are not like your ultrasonic tips which are used in perio, because endodontics you have everything which is a very small size. So the ultrasonic tips, of course, are also very very thin, very very narrow. So you can actually attach these ultrasonic tips in the junction between the pulp stone and the pulp chamber, and with the ultrasonic movement you can actually dislodge your pulp stone. Calcified canals again. You can actually use your ultrasonics to trough through your dentine without causing major damage, and you can actually find your calcified canals. Yeah. Removal of intracanal obstructions. You can use your ultrasonics to remove separated instruments. You can use them to remove your root canal posts, silver points. I'm sure you all know what silver points are. These were the materials of choice for obturation initially. But of course, because of their corrosive nature and difficulty to remove the silver points for retreatment, they have been substituted with your traditional, with your now universal gutta percha and root canal sealer. And it can also be used to remove your fractured metallic posts. However, all of this is easier said than done. Removing a separated instrument with the help of an ultrasonic. This can be done preferably if the instrument is separated in the coronal to the middle third. Okay, in the apical third, it's a whole different story altogether, because the ultrasonic tip actually has to reach to the apical third, which is not very easy because of the curvature and the complex anatomy, especially when it comes to the posteriors. Removing root canal posts, of course, yes, you can use the ultrasonics. You can try to break the junction between the post and the adhesive which has been used to loot the post into the canal. So if cracks develop inside that adhesive, most of the cases it's going to be GIC or compomer. So in that case, if you're able to weaken the adhesive material and the looting agent, then it improves the chances of you retrieving your root canal post also. Yeah. You can use it to activate your irrigating solutions. So when you have your irrigants like sodium hypochloride and chlorhexidine, generally we use our passive mode of irrigation. That means we are just using our normal syringe. However, even if you use your normal syringe and you have dispelled the irrigant into your root canal, you can increase the efficiency by actually activating it with the help of your endosonics or your ultrasonics in endodontics. Please note that endosonics is nothing but the ultrasonics which are used in endodontics. Okay, so how do you activate it is you fill up the entire root canal with your irrigating solution, then you insert the ultrasonic tip and you just start the vibration. That means you activate your ultrasonic tip. This will also activate your irrigating solution, so the efficacy increases manifold. Yeah, you can also use your ultrasonics for condensation of gutta percha. So this is used preferably for your surgical endodontics, where you would like to condense your gutta percha in the retrograde direction. So this will be covered in your surgical endodontics. Placement of your mineral trioxide aggregate. Again, mineral trioxide aggregate is generally used for as a root end filling material. However, a mineral trioxide aggregate can also be used for apexogenesis and apexification now. So even if you want to place it inside the pulp chamber, or if you want to place it just as in a normal cavity also, you can use your ultrasonics to actually place the mineral trioxide aggregate. Because of the thin tip, it will be able to easily place your mineral trioxide aggregate. Okay. For surgical endodontics, you can use your ultrasonics or your endosonics for your root end cavity preparation. You can use it for refinement and placement of your root end obturation material. So your root end obturation material is nothing but your MTA and biodentine. Your root end cavity preparation. So after you have, so basically in your surgical endodontics, you have to do something known as root end resection, wherein at least 3 mm of your root end tip has to be cut, and that is to get rid of all your apical ramifications and lateral and accessory canals, because 98% of the lateral and accessory canals are located in the root end. That is the 3 mm root end of your tooth. So to get rid of that, so that you prevent your subsequent infection, you have to do your root end resection. So after you do your root end resection, you can do a little bit of root end cavity preparation, because you have to create a cavity in order to place your root end obturating material, that is your MTA. So to do the cavity preparation, you can use your ultrasonics. And of course, you can use it for your root canal preparation also. So ultrasonics can help during your cleaning and shaping as well. So of course, when you are using your rotary files, if you use your ultrasonic tips to activate your root canal irrigants also, the outcome, that is your prognosis of your root canal treatment, also increases manifold. Okay, so this is it for today's lecture. Like I said, it's a two-part lecture. So if you have any doubts regarding this first part of the lecture, please feel free to contact me. You can post your comments in the comment section, and I'll be more than happy to get back to you guys. Okay, so until next week, stay safe and take care, guys. See you.